Greetings. This has become part E in my response to a response about Isaiah 42:12. Let's refresh exactly where we were. When did Kedar proclaim God and his law for the Gentiles in the world with war? Did that happen? Yes, it did, and you know it. But how could barefooted Arabs from the desert, who were of in fewer number, completely defeat two superpowers with the Romans and Persians in such short time? Surely only with the help of Jehovah. First, let's address Kedar and war. I think this is largely answered by actually viewing what I covered in part 132. There is no mention of Kedar and war in Isaiah 42. But let's go over the Kedar portion again. Isaiah 42, verse 10. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise from the ends of the earth. You who go down to the sea and all that is in it, you islands and all who dwell in them. What is this about? A statement to sing to Jehovah a new song and sing his praise. Who is to sing? You who fish, meaning go down to the sea, and the fish in the sea, even the islands and those living in the islands. No mention of the law or of war. Let the desert and its cities raise their voices. Let the villages of Kedar cry aloud. Let the people of Selah sing for joy. Let them cry out from the mountaintops. They are told to make some kind of noise. Does it say what kind of noise to make? It does in the previous verse. Sing to the Lord a new song, his praise from the ends of the earth. No mention of law or of war. Let's look again at the three groups and what they were commanded. Let the desert and its cities raise their voices. Let the villages of Kedar cry aloud. Let the people of Selah sing for joy. Let them cry out from the mountaintops. Raise voices. Cry aloud. Sing for joy. Worship Jehovah God. You are free from Islam's slavery. No mention of law or of war. And if you have any doubt what raised voices are to be doing, just simply keep reading. The very next verse. Let them give glory to the Lord, Jehovah, and declare his praise in the islands. This is all about praise and giving glory to Jehovah God. No mention of Allah or Islam. No mention of law or of war. This is all about praising Jehovah God. This foretells a time when Kedar will worship Jehovah and not the Allah of Mohammed. So where does Islam get this completely irrational and insane idea of law and or war in Isaiah 42:12? The next verse actually changes subject and topic. That would be 42:13. It is not about singing to or praising Jehovah. It is about Jehovah himself. And this is where Islam commits blasphemy. Islam steals the meaning of the next verse, which is about Jehovah God, and applies it to the man, Muhammad. Isaiah 42:13, the Lord, Jehovah. Who is this verse clearly talking about? Any Muslim care to venture a guess? Jehovah, the Lord. The Lord, Jehovah, goes forth like a mighty one. What does God, the Lord, Jehovah, do? He goes forth like a mighty one. Other translations render mighty one as variously champion, mighty man, mighty one, and warrior. And because Mohammedism is hopelessly desperate, to find and steal credentials for Mohammed from the Bible, they see one word that only appears in some translations, warrior. And the only person they can imagine resembles this is their most brutal leader, Mohammed. Remember, and never forget, this is talking about God, the Lord, Jehovah, not some warlord, Mohammed. The Lord, Jehovah, goes forth like a mighty one. He stirs up his zeal like a warrior. Here again, we see the word warrior, which Islam fixates on. But it is a blasphemous rape of this verse to think he and his magically refer to anyone other than Jehovah God, the Lord. Yet this is what those who submit to Muhammad in Islam do. When did Kedar proclaim God and his law for the Gentiles in the world with war? You've seen Isaiah 42:12. And there is nothing except the word war in the word warrior that has any tie to an imagined history of Islam. Did that happen? Were there wars in the Arabian Peninsula? Sure. Did they proclaim God? Absolutely not. They proclaimed the Arabian deity Allah. But he's not God of anything except those heading to the flames. He stirs up his zeal like a warrior. He shouts, yes. He roars in triumph over his enemies. All of this refers to Jehovah God. Notice, no mention of law, of teaching the law, of giving the law, of sharing the law. And the only mention of Kedar was singing praise to Jehovah once they are free of Mohammedism. The Lord, Jehovah, goes forth like a mighty one. He stirs up his zeal like a warrior. He shouts, yes! He roars in triumph over his enemies. But how could barefooted Arabs from the desert, who were in fewer number, completely defeat two superpowers with the Romans and Persians in such a short time? That's an irrelevant question to begin with, because it has nothing to do with the scripture being abused by a Muslim. That aside, Islam promised virgins and eternal paradise to barefooted Arabs from the desert if they would fight to the death. Islam also murdered anyone who quit Islam, which also motivated fighters. Surely only with the help of Jehovah. That is an unsupported and irrational leap to make. You are attempting to appeal to a scenario you consider and want others to believe is impossible. Then you try and hide the deity of Muhammad, which he insisted was Allah of the Arabian Peninsula. Evidently you are ashamed of Allah and know in your heart that Allah the distant, Allah the missing, Allah the impotent could do and did do nothing. Any supernatural help that contributed must have come from the one true God, Jehovah. If anything, brother, you argue for leaving Islam and Muhammad's servitude to worship Jehovah, the one true God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob. Surely only with the help of Jehovah. Why else would you try to change the name of Muhammad's deity to the Jewish God, Jehovah? But has Islam served a purpose? Yes, the same as Babylon and other pagan nations that Jehovah used to chastise Israel. And Islam will serve a significant role as the religion of the Antichrist in these last days. So, does Isaiah 42:12 offer any evidence or credentials to Muhammad as having any authority from Jehovah God, the God of Abraham, Isaac, and Jacob? No, but it does demonstrate how very desperate Mohammedism is to invent some, any, credentials for Mohammed. Desperate to prove that Surah 7:157 is not a bold-faced lie damning the so-called Prophet Muhammad. I encourage you, brother, flee Mohammedism's evil, blasphemous lies before it is too late, because the time of the Gentiles is coming to an end. May the Spirit of God open your eyes to the light and your ears to the truth, and your heart to His Son, the Lord Jesus Christ. Amen.